don't you, if you're at all serious in this matter, why don't you ask yourself that question? Why am I a human being who have been through all this? Why haven't I changed? What would be your answer?
The speaker that you were seeing there is Jiddu Krishnamurti. And he was a great champion of inquiry. And he was able, through his own inquiry, to see the problematic nature of existence. And it's extremely important that without teachers like him coming into the world, we would really be lost. But because teachers like him did come into the world, and they showed us right emphasis, where should we put our efforts? And he said, basically, that it's not enough for some authority to tell us what we should believe. That we have to see it for ourselves. If we don't see it for ourselves, it's going to lead to bad results. It's going to lead to conflict, to war, to insecurities, all problems. And so he told us that we must see it for ourselves. And how do we see things for ourselves? How do we see truth for ourselves? Through inquiry. And I've said it should be cradle to grave. It should be the first and last teachings of this world and everything in between. The emphasis should always be on you have to see it for yourself. But instead, what has happened is we've been too clever. We think, you know what? There must be a shortcut. And what is the shortcut? We find some charismatic figure who wants to be worshipped, and we say, we'll worship you if you just tell us what the truth is, and we'll believe you, and that's good enough. We'll all call it good enough. Okay. But no true spiritual teacher would ever call that good enough. All spiritual teachers say the same thing. What do they say? You have to see it for yourself. That is the first and last teaching. And there's no other real teaching in between. You have to see it for yourself. Meaning you have to engage in the effort that it takes to see it for yourself. And of course, it seems as though in this world, we are always trying to be more efficient, right? You say the business of America is business. Meaning efficiency. Business is all about how can we do it quickly, more efficiently, more productively. How can we find the shortcuts? But on the spiritual path of inquiry, of seeing it for yourself, there are no shortcuts. Hard work is the shortcut. Doing it is the shortcut. There isn't any other shortcut. But we're all waiting for shortcuts, and we're willing to flock to anyone who provides a shortcut, we think. But what happens is we end up idolizing them and thinking that if we just idolize them, which seems very easy for us, right, that they're going to supply whatever we're missing. They're going to supply the clarity externally. There's some kind of external clarity. No. Clarity is within. You cannot get in a pill form. You cannot get it in and through the eyes of true seeing and clarity. It's very simple. It's very obvious. It's no big trumpets are going off. You simply say, I'm seeing it. When you're seeing something, do you make a big deal about it? No, it's very obvious. You say, I'm seeing that. I don't need to write a book about it. I'm seeing it. Now, you're not figuring it out. Someone's not giving it to you. You yourself are seeing it. And so then for you, it's obvious. Look, when we see something, we don't need somebody to describe it to us, do we? We only need to have someone describe to us what we're not seeing. And when we're not seeing. We're not seers, are Nazis. Very close, isn't it? Nazis, Nazis, Nazis. What were the Nazis? Those who were not seeing, not seeing, Nazis. They put all their faith in external idolatry. Great leader, tell us what is true. What are you seeing? Tell us, and we'll follow whatever you say. Because as they thought, this is a shortcut to greatness. This is a shortcut to being super people, super race, all of that. So nobody was working on seeing it for themselves. They said, well, we don't need to see it for ourselves. Let's take someone else's word for it. So all true teachers say, you must see it for yourself. That's it. That's the beginning and the end of the path. And of course, when you see it for yourself, you don't need anyone else to really describe it for you. If you don't see it, enter the demagogue. Demagogue says, bread and circuses for everyone. Everybody take it easy. You can need food, cell phone, television, car. That's all you need. And then just follow along with what we're saying. And everything will be great for you. We'll tell you what's been being seen. You don't have to see it. That's the demagogue. Okay. Those are those who are promoting idolatry and demagoguery, hero worship, all that stuff. Those are the anti-teachers. They call him Antichrist. Christ is your own multidimensional beingness. And in order to function that way, you have to see through your own forgetfulness. Okay, you have to drop your forgetfulness. You do that by seeing through the forgetfulness, by seeing what's going on. If you're not engaged in that effort to truly see and to exchange forgetfulness for remembrance, then you're engaged in forgetting what you are, forgetting your true identity, forgetting your functionality. So you're engaged in trying to forget about Christ, Christ consciousness. So you're anti-Christ consciousness. You're against remembering it. You're trying to establish a new reality. And that's the direction the demagogues, the heroes, the idols, all of those are encouraging. The pipers of forgetfulness are encouraging you in that direction. What is the remedy for that? Is inquiry. What is inquiry? It is simply engaging in careful observation, careful awareness, careful questioning, looking, seeing, does this fit together? Is this really true? And then turning to reason. Is this truly reason or is it plausibility? You know, and everybody has the capacity to do this. It's innate within us. It's something we can't get rid of. So every single one has the capacity of self-inquiry. But, you know, very few are doing it. Because why? It's hard work. It's tough work. But a life without self-inquiry, that inquiry is also very, very tough work. Very tough. And it gets tougher. So either way, in this life, you're going to have a tough road to hoe. No matter what you do. Life is tough. Well, this isn't life, but existence is tough no matter what you do. So you might as well spend your time aiming to get free of existence. Because what is existence? It's forgetfulness of reality. That's all that it is. Pretty easy. Once you see that, then it frees up an enormous amount of attention. Because all the questions of existence have been answered. What is existence? It's simply a play of forgetfulness. It's how we're forgetting reality, or how we are maintaining a state of forgetfulness of reality. That's all that it is. So, how do we treat existence? By using our time and effort to remember what we are, to be willing to drop the forgetfulness of what we are and accept the remembrance of what we are. That's our responsibility, that's our duty, that's right use of time, right use of effort, right use of mind. That's it. Very simple. There are not any deep mysteries about existence at all. No mysteries whatsoever. No depth to it whatsoever. It's like once you realize you're dreaming, where's the mystery of the dream? You're in this dream and all this stuff's happening. Then you say, wait a minute, I'm making all this up. It's just a dream. Where's the mystery then of the dream? There's no mystery. You know it's a dream, and you know who's dreaming it and why they're dreaming it. So where's it? Is it gone? No mystery. Existence, who's the dreamer? Spirit is the dreamer. Why is spirit dreaming it? Because spirit wants to be prime creator. And in order to be prime creator, it has to forget, be in a forgetfulness of what it is, which is not prime creator. It has to forget, try to forget what it is, be in a state of forgetfulness. So, and then how is a dream arising? Is it arising because mind is presenting it to spirit? Mind is the presenter of ideas, the creative flow of reality. So you have the purpose. It's all wrapped up right there, very simple. Why? Who's doing it? Who's the dreamer? Spirit. Why? Wants to be prime creator. How's the dream arising? Through mind. No more mystery. No more mystery to it. Then say, well, you know, in a dream, you have to track everything down in the dream and solve riddles and stuff. No, you don't need to solve anything. Do you need to figure out the dream stuff? No. You don't need to know anything about existence as far as science and materiality and all this stuff. Useless. Completely wasted your time. All you have to know that is why is this arising? Who is causing this to arise? Hey, cat. Cat probably hungry. Come on. And that's all you need to know. You don't need to discover anything else at all. Don't need to discover anything else at all. Right, cat? Now think, you see, instead of doing inquiry, we spend time trying to figure out existence, figure out the universe. That's like someone in a dream trying to scope out the dream. Say, what's going on in this dream? I'm going to figure out what's going on in this dream. Instead of simply waking up from the dream. How wise is it for a dreamer to be exploring the dream and reacting to the dream as if it was real, trying to learn everything they can about what's going on in the dream. Identify all figures, what their names are, what they're doing, what their destinies are, what their tendencies are, where the places are in the dream, how to get to those places. What use is that at all? Isn't it better to simply realize who the dreamer is? And why is the dream taking place? And then realize, the dream is taking place because I wanted to be prime creator. Therefore, I had to try and forget what I am. But now I realize it's impossible. Forgetfulness can never be eternal. It's only temporary. And so what use is it? Whatever I come up with in the dream, it's going to be swept away by remembrance at some point anyway. I can never become prime creator. I can only plausibly pretend to temporarily be prime creator. as a plausible possibility. That's the most I can come up with in existence. So what's the use? What's the use of continuing to scope out the dream? So we don't need to be exploring the cosmos. We don't need to be exploring this world. We don't need to be categorizing anything, experimenting on anything, trying to figure stuff out, trying to calculate stuff. Not at all. No reason for any of that. All I need to do is to realize the whole package situation. Who's the dreamer? Why are we dreaming? And how do we wake up to remembrance? How do we let go of the dream? That's it. And in order to do that, we have to be in a spirit of inquiry. That's the only way. And what's a spirit of inquiry? A spirit of inquiry is simply to sit quietly and consider these questions. Consider what is important. Try to find out what's really important. And it's not easy because all of this stuff is coming at us constantly about how important it is to get information within the dream. Find out who are the important people. You know, who has more information about this dream and can help us succeed within it. How do we succeed? It's just unbelievable the amount of distraction that you come up with. And there's always, you know, something trying to pull you away from your inquiry, like this cat right now. This cat is here, and the cat wants me to feed the cat, you know, wants food. And it's not going to leave me alone, you know, until I get the cat food. He says, you know, feed me, feed me, feed me. And I say, cat, I'm doing a video here. We're focusing on inquiry. And the cat says, well, you know, that's to the cat. It's not that important, right, cat? Yeah. He doesn't see the importance of that, of the video, right? And so part of us are like that, this cat, that, you know, we just simply want to live the life of an animal in this world. Creature comforts. See what kind of creature comforts we can come up with. Maybe roam around, check stuff out, maybe even investigate some stuff. But that's, you know, that's pretty much it. And yet there's a part of us that wants to awaken from this dream. And that part of us has to be in the ascendant and has to insist upon the time to do this. And cannot always bend to the will of the creature comforts, demanding creature comforts. We say, well, get you some food a little bit later, though. You know, you can wait a little while. The cat can wait. Your demand for immediate gratification can wait. As we do the satsang, the inquiry. Let's listen to Krishnamurti here.
You are not serious. You want to live a very, very superficial life. And that superficiality temporarily satisfies you. Or you really don't care. As long as you have immediate pleasures, immediate satisfactions, you really don't care. You don't care for your children if they are murdered.
All right. I've removed the cat. You see. See, so we can do that. We can remove the cat. We can remove those demands for immediate creature comfort demands. And we could say, look, I've got something more important to deal with. You just go over there and sit for a while. That's how we do it. That's how we do the inquiry. Now you saw Krishnamurti just sitting there very comfortably in a chair, simple chair, just sitting there. Not trying to do anything athletic. Athleticism is not inquiry. Speaking of that, I think there's probably the home run hitting contest is going on here July 9th, 2012. But again, that's athleticism. That's not inquiry. So we can let that take place and we don't have to pay attention to it. In one way, cats are helpful because they know how to sit very still. See? But this sitting has to be very attentive sitting. It's not like you're sleeping. Your mind is focused on the process of the dream and saying, is this real? You know, is this a dream? Is what's going on? What's the purpose of this dream anyway? What's the purpose of all existence? Why am I here in the first place? What's my identity? What is my destiny? How come I'm suffering? How come I'm afraid? How come I'm not happy? How come things are so tough? How come I don't feel secure? How come I can't sleep? How come my mind is troubled? How come my mind seems to act weird when I go to sleep? There's weird dreams. How come I'm not certain? How come all of this is, you know, why is all this the way that it is? How come I'm not getting answers? That's all inquiry. Like that. How come I'm just seeing fragments? How come I'm always driven to imagining? How come I seem to get compulsive? How come I seem to lack attention? How come I don't seem to be able to see the best way? How come I can't be more successful? How come I, you know, feel lonely or isolated? How come this? How come that? It's weird. I mean, you go say, how come the world's so weird? How come I'm having so much trouble? How come I can't find the answers? How come I don't see anyone else having answers? How come I'm right? How come the world is the way that it is? How come we have strife? How come we have conflict? How come we have injustice? How come we have all these teachings? How come the teachings are conflicted? How come I'm born and then and get old and die? Why am I the way that I am? And then you say also, how come I remember something different than here? Where is that memory coming from? How come I feel homesick? For where? How come this place is really not it? How come I've had these flashes of something else? Is that something else real and this is a dream? Or is this real and those flashes of something else are a dream? See? How come all of that? That's inquiry. That's inquiry, you know, just sitting and taking stock of your life. And just keep doing that, you know, just get used to saying, oh, wait a minute, wait, Let not the tide of activity draw me away from asking these bigger questions, you know, these important questions. Let me not get pulled away from that. How come I'm tired, you know? There's another question we can all ask. How come there's so much competition? How come there's scarcity? Is this real? Is this my home? Am I to dwell here forever? Who is this stuff? Why is this stuff here in the first place? Why is this scenario here? Why does everything die? Why does there seem to be so much difference in the world? Differences. Why does it get dark? Why does it get cold or hot? Why do I feel uncomfortable? Why do I get sick? Where does that come from? How come I'm getting sick? These are basic questions that we all ask ourselves from time to time. But we tend to just hope that these conditions will move on. And we don't really dig deep into them. We just hope, why am I so, seem so insignificant? Well, maybe tomorrow I won't feel so insignificant, so I don't really need to worry about it. Let's just hope for some sort of change. Why is everything changing? Why is everything impermanent? Another question. Why is my concentration so poor? Why do I have a hard time putting two and two together and seeing things, seeing through the deceptions of the world? We just hope all these will clear up somehow, magically. They'll get better and disappear. We don't really have to get any answers. We just kind of make some complaints and hope complaints. But we are told that we need to actually see the answer to all these questions before anything can really take place. Instead of just hoping that tomorrow I won't be bothered by these questions, don't think it's a botheration. Actually, you know, grab a hold of these questions and make sure that you ask these questions. And keep insisting on an answer that fits. Keep trying to find a theory in which everything, all these questions have an answer. Because then that's the only way. That's called seeing. You see that, this theory resolves all these questions. You have the answer to the questions. Inquiry does arrive at an answer. And from that clear seeing, you say, I see how this whole situation works, where it arises from, why it arises, and how to exchange it for another scenario. This other scenario being like unconditional love, multidimensional functioning, and really reality, which is a true scenario. It's not a hypothetical. It's actual. The birds are creating a commotion right there. We might ask why are the birds creating a commotion? Why is there a commotion? Why is there battle over territories? Why is there conflict? I see. There's a squirrel, and the bird is trying to attack the squirrel and drive it away from its nest, apparently. That's what's going on. So, we can look at that And okay, here's an example of how can we use inquiry in this situation. Let's say the squirrel is the spirit of inquiry. Okay, and the bird is trying to prevent the squirrel from discovering its quote-unquote nest, where the eggs are, which are the basic who is dreaming and why is the dream arising and what is supplying the dream. Those three essentials. The squirrel is very adventurous and full of inquiries. Says, I wanna see what's up there in that tree. So the squirrel's climbing up that tree, and the bird is coming at it, screeching and flapping the wings, and trying to frighten the bird off, frighten the squirrel off. And the squirrel, you know, says, No, I'm very adventurous. I wanna find out what's in that nest, and tries to continue on in the face of all this assault and attack and distraction and screeching and wings flapping. And the bird was really creating a tremendous commotion. The squirrel is not going to eat the eggs, not going to destroy the nest or do anything. The squirrel just want to kind of, you know, what's there? Wants to see. Sees the nest. Oh, okay, there's the nest, there's the eggs. Okay, I know it's there. Inquiry sees the dreamer. Why the dream is being, the purpose of the dream, why is it being just upset? And how is the dream inside? The dreamer is spirit. The purpose of the dream is to forget what we are so that we can be prime, so we can imagine that we can be primer. We can pretend that's plausible that we can be prime creator because we're not aware of what we really are. And then what's supplying the dream? The mind. Mind is supplying the dream. Okay, mind is supplying existence. Existence arises from mind. It's a projection, a mental projection, projection of mind, projection that is custom designed to enable us to be forgetful of what we are. When we are aware of existence, we have amnesia about what we are. Really, you've heard cases of amnesia. People forget their identity entirely. They don't know their name, where they came from, how old they are, nothing. Well, existence is like amnesia for us, for spirit. Spirit forgets that it's spirit. It forgets reality. It forgets its functioning. It forgets what created it. It forgets everything. And then it's now seeking for answers within the dream. Like, where can I find my identity within this dream of forgetfulness of what I am? And, of course, the spirit cannot find its identity within the dream of forgetting what it is. It has to give up search. Say, I can't find myself here in this dream. And guess what? I don't need to. Because I still am what I am. But I'll never know that unless I dream another dream or give up this dream of forgetfulness. And see instead a dream of remembrance, a reflection of what I am. Experience the overly unconditional love that reminds me of what I am, because it's not changing. It's not forgetting what it is. See an effect that is not trying to change what it is, change itself. In existence, everything is perpetually undergoing change. I mean, constant modification. In other words, nothing in existence is staying as it is. So it's a picture of total forgetfulness of what is, right? There is nothing you can point to existence and say, you know, that is what it is. Nothing. Nothing. It's only impermanence. And so it's really nothing at all except a play of forgetfulness, play of modification. So what we need is to experience a dream that where nothing has changed, there's no modification, an effect that is not being modified. And then that will remind us that, reality, what we are, can't be modified or changed. We'll remember that. So we'll remember identity, our functioning, our reality, our home. But not by paying attention to impermanence and modification. Cannot remember what we are that way. So it doesn't matter if you're looking at a beautiful lake, a beautiful sunset, a beautiful beach, beautiful vista landscape, a beautiful person listening to beautiful music, eating wonderful food, whatever, you know, reading a great novel, and whatever, you know, whatever adventure you're having in this world, Everything you're dealing with is impermanent. It's all changing. There's nothing that is, simply is what it is. So you can't possibly remember what you are, no matter what experiencing you're having in existence. You're simply reinforcing forgetfulness of what you are. And so how do you, in existence, how do you remember? By seeing the overlay of unconditional love upon all of existence. Because then you put that primary and say, ah, this, I can remember my identity by looking at this. And the rest of this stuff, it's not important. And I don't need it. I don't need to get rid of it because I'm not paying attention to it, really. It's like a shadow. Shadow's there, but I'm paying attention to what's there instead of the shadow. It's just like a flickering shadow or like a candle, a flickering flame. You see the sun and you say, ah, why do I need to worry about the flickering candle flame when I have the sun for light? So whatever the candle does, whether it flickers, how it flickers, doesn't matter. You're not intently studying the flickering of a candle. Like, we're like in existence, it's like we're like paying attention to this faint flickering flame, you know, and we're trying to learn everything we can from this flame, and we think this flame is teaching us something profound. No, it's not. Once you see the sun, you're not interested in studying the flickering candle flame. Whatever it does doesn't matter. So whatever existence does, once you realize, experience unconditional love, multidimensionality, peace beyond understanding, once you experience that, which is not changing, you don't have anything to try and learn anything from that flickering candle flame, from existence, from impermanence, from constant change. You have any reason to pay attention to that, learn anything from it. It's still there as far as functionality goes, but you're not trying to learn anything from it. You still go down to the store and you get your, you know, vegetables and your bread and whatever you want, you know, for dinner. But you're not trying to learn something from going down to the store and getting food and eating the food. You're not looking at it as I need to find my identity somehow through these actions, through paying attention to this stuff. No. You just function in a practical manner, but there's no drama as far as trying to discover something within this realm of existence. You realize that you can't discover yourself in this realm, but you've already discovered yourself through experiencing the unconditional love. You see reflection of what you are, which is permanence, which is that which cannot be modified. So you see, inquiry gets you to see all this stuff. It's very reasonable, isn't it? Put this way, it's very, very reasonable. Of course, we don't need to be obsessed about the flickering of a candle flame when we have the sun to light it away, right? That's easy to realize that. It's only those that are in darkness that are obsessed with the flickering candle flame. You know, trying to read secret messages and it's flickering. Trying to figure out, you know, where does this flame come from? And how can I make it last? And worshiping that candle flame and doing all sorts of rituals with it and for it. Of praise and sacrificing ones, all sorts of stuff for the candle flame. And once we have the sun, we say, ah, all of that was just, you know, silly. We did it because we didn't realize we had access to this sun, this great light. So that's the same situation with our identity, with reality. Once we realize it, we don't need to engage in all sorts of the silliness trying to appease existence as if existence, you know, can somehow show us what we are. No, what existence does is show us a plausible way to forget what we are. What it doesn't show us is how to permanently forgive you. But see, we think that's in the future. We think that's what we're going to get in the future if we just hang in there. We'll have to permanently forget what we are. So every single moment in the future for us is that hope. That's what's keeping us as far as paying attention to existence, thinking there's something there we can get, is we think that we can get permanent forgetfulness. It becomes permanent. At that point, we think we'll have peace of mind. That's the magical belief, that we'll have this perfect peace of mind, because the tendency to remember, we think that it'll vanish. And so we will not be troubled by that anymore. Troubled by this nagging feeling, you know, this feeling like something's wrong. You know, what is this? What is that? If so that is what keeps us going moment by moment by moment, believing in existence, is that this moment we should get it. We should be able to get this perfect forgetfulness. And of course we never do, which is why we're here in this moment saying, you know, what's going on here? How come I don't have it? How come I don't have what I'm looking for? So this is just inquiry. This is just talk. This is similar to what Krishnamurti did. It's a very simple, clear exposition and bringing these things up and saying, why not look at it this way? Why not consider this? And the mind, the spirit can do it. Absolutely. It's simply a question of doing it, you know? It's not all glamorous. There's not a lot of glamour to it, really. But the payoff eventually will be, you know, infinite riches. So there is a great intelligence to it. Those who do inquiry are very intelligent, very smart, very wise, because they know how to attain their true riches. They're pursuing true riches, and that is very wise, very smart. They might not come up with it right away, but they're in a high-speed pursuit. And so we're like that, in high-speed pursuit of the truth. It's like we're on this car chase, you know, and trying to track it down. And of course, when you're in a car chase, you got to be alert, you know, you have to give your attention to it. Because truth seems to be fleeing from us, even though it's not. It seems like we have to chase it down, because it seems to be covered up with all sorts of defenses, you know. And we have that, like, we have that bird, like, that came into the squirrel, that is squawking at us and shouting at us and saying, don't you dare go there. That's off limits. That's taboo. And this bird is coming at us, and the squirrels, we're trying to dodge it, you know, and get around it. And it seems like it takes a long time to come. Krishnamurti said, why don't people change? I think that's what he was saying over here. Let's see what he's saying.
If you really have no deep love, affection for them, if you had, you would prevent all wars. So, apparently...
Okay, he was talking about preventing all wars. Yesterday, I posted a video where I finally... finally laid out what's the cause, what are the dynamics behind oppression in this world, dynamics behind wars, etc., and finally been able to lay that out very clearly. So the answer, you know, is very, very simple. You have to awaken to your true identity. You have to give up trying to forget what you are. It's the only way. If we have a world that is engaged in waking up to what truly engaged with inquiry, there won't be any wars. Now the world won't be free of conflict entirely. No, I mean there'll still be preferences and irritations, etc., but it won't break into war. No, there'll be a spirit of forgiveness. If each one realizes, oh, that other one's engaged in inquiry, okay, let him be. Let's not bother him. Let's not disturb him. Let's not distract him. Let's not have any troubles. That is the way to avoid war. There's one way to avoid war. The world has to be engaged in inquiry, spiritual inquiry, not material inquiry. Material inquiry leads to war, leads to tremendous war. Inquiry into that universe and how does it work and how can we get more energy, more power, and do these things, that leads to war. What it leads to, because the purpose of existence is to establish spirit as prime creator, which means, well, there's two purposes. One, it has to forget. We have to forget what we are, and we're trying to then establish a new reality, because by establishing a new reality, we feel that we go beyond forgetting what we are, where now we don't even need to forget what we are because we become something new. And that we think that'll be ultimate peace of mind. If we can just establish a new reality, a new identity, establish ourselves a prime creator, we'll have peace of mind. And of course we think then we'll have peace, no more conflict, no more war. But how do we attain this? Again, in the video, last video of the Inquisition, I put forth this fundamental truth. I've been fortunate enough to be able to have to bring this into the world. And very simply, how do we try to accomplish the impossible? The goal is to establish ourselves as prime creator, so we don't have to constantly battle with the struggle with this forgetting what we are. In order to establish ourselves as prime creator, we have to have a creation that completes us. Cause without any effects cannot be said to be a real cause. So we cannot be said to be prime creators if we have a creation that proves that we're prime creators, right? In order to be prime creator, we have to have eternal, endless creation, because if the creation could come to the end, how could we truly be creators? We'd only be temporary, you know, wouldn't be real. So in order to be creators, have creation, it must be an endless eternal creation. How do we know that it's endless and eternal? Because this is a fact. Facts, you know, rules, laws that govern this, this is the way it functions, the functionality of our creation has to be a fact, factual, meaning endless, cannot be changed. A fact is something that cannot be changed. So if we say this is the way that our creation functions, this has to be a fact. It has to be endless for us to say we're prime creators. So you have to establish facts. That's the reality, you know, this is prime creator, this is prime created, this is this is how spirit functions with mind, idea, and experiencing. This is the flow. This is, it's permanent. It's invulnerable. You know, it's endless. All these things are facts. So we have to establish facts about our creation, how it functions. So we have to, so how do we establish facts in existence? We have to come up with, well, and so what we do is, because existence is simply a process, because it's impermanent, here's where we run into the trouble. So here's where conflict arises. Because we think, how in the world can we establish facts in what is impermanent, is constantly changing and permanent? And we think, well, we can do it simply by everyone agreeing that something is a fact. And how do we do that? Well, we do it by having no dissent. If there's no dissent, we can then say, it must be unanimous. And if it's unanimous agreement, then that unanimous agreement must be a fact. And if that's a fact, it must be eternal. If it's eternal, that means existence must have come from a prime creator. And therefore, since we're the ones existing in these things, we must be the prime creator. So there's that chain of plausibility, you see. So how do we establish facts? Again, no dissent. How do we establish no dissent? There you go. Welcome to the problems of the world, right? Very simple and easy to see that. How do we establish no dissent? By getting rid of dissent. How do we get rid of dissent? See? Ah. There you go. Right? Various means of persuasion. You know, different types, right? All different types. And there you see the play of existence, the play of history. Play of history is simply getting rid of dissent, trying to get rid of dissent. And when systems arise that say, no, let us allow dissent, because our goal is to awaken from this dream. See, wise beings try to construct situations in this world where a dissent is allowed and appreciated, and say it's okay, because we're trying to awaken from the dream instead, and not trying to establish ourselves as prime creators, but to accept what we are in reality. And they know that in order, you know, that this is crucial, that allowing dissent is absolutely crucial. In fact, actually encouraging it. When I grew up here in the United States, dissent was encouraged. And so for me, that's you know, it's freedom of speech really means freedom of dissent is all important. The atmosphere of allowing dissent without hating the dissenters, but keeping, in fact, appreciating the dissenters. I appreciate them. Those who are saying, now, wait a minute, you know, is this not automaton dissent, not simply protesting just to be a protester or anything like that, no, but simply someone who's engaged in inquiry saying, now, wait a minute, is this it? I don't know if this is it. What the senators are saying, I don't know. We don't know. We're not really sure about this. And also saying there might be an answer. I'm not quite sure if there is or there isn't. But if there is, that's okay too. You know, it's saying it's a spirit of inquiry. Inquiry is not claiming there's no answer, because obviously awakening to our true identity is the answer. So there is an answer. In other words, letting go of the dream is the answer. Remember the answer. But there are people saying, well, you know, we're not sure what to do. We're not sure if this is it or that is it. We're trying to find out what it is, but we're not sure. Okay, looking at both sides of things, trying to come up with the answer and yet not being there. Dissent, allowing dissent, is all important. Of course, people abuse this and end up in a simply attack. That's not dissent. It's not intelligent consideration. It's not saying, well, I've not arrived at a conclusion yet. Is that okay? Of course. on any issue. You say, I haven't arrived at a conclusion. I'm not yet clear about what the conclusion is. That's dissent. What dissent is saying, I don't yet have a conclusion. And saying, is that okay? Of course. And even if one says, well, I mean, dissent has to be allowed. The alternative to that is terrible. The alternative to putting up with dissent and putting up with some of the foolishness that, you know, hoaxers and jokesters and mischievous minds come up with, putting up with that is the price you pay. Of course, some people will be mischievous about this, and their dissent is not in a spirit of inquiry, but just, you know, being juvenile about the whole thing. That, of course, that happens. You know, just gamesmanship and one-upmanship and all this very juvenile functioning. That happens. Of course, that happens. And you have to put up with that, and the spirit of inquiry has to continue. So, you know, freedom of speech is the most important policy of all. And that means a tolerance of free speech is the most important attitude of all. The tolerance of dissent in all directions. And, you know, it's so even the dissenter who says, I'm dissenting because you are all wrong. My position is right. And I refuse to tolerate your position at all. Is that dissent? No. The spirit of dissent is say, I don't see that your position is accurate or right, but I fully support you holding a different position than mine. And I'm not going to go after your reputation. I'm not going to go after your job. I'm not going to go after your family. I'm not trying to hurt you. I'm not going to try and put a witch hunt on you or anything. In fact, I'm going to protect your right to hold a different position than mine. That's the America I grew up in. That's the ideal of the USA. It's ideal to the entire planet. And it's that which is under attack. That is what is under the most grievous assault. We don't love each other the way we used to. You know, I love the fact that somebody has a different viewpoint. I respect them. You know, I'll listen to opposite viewpoints of what I believe in. I will respect people who are courageous enough to speak up and say, this is how I see it. Now, even though I may realize it's mistaken, I love and respect the fact that they're courageous enough to say, you know, what about this? Is this, maybe this is a good way to look at it. What do you think? And then if you say, well, I don't agree with it, there's another way. They might say, well, you know, I haven't looked at it that way, and I don't really think that's true, but I respect you for at least your opinion. You know, there are still people who are that way, very few. Rarely do you hear it. Sometimes I hear it like on a sports talk show. An older host who still has this, they'll say, and you know, I don't agree with it, but I really appreciate that, you know, you feel, you know, expressing your viewpoint here, and you know, it's something that maybe we should consider. You know, that it may seem funny that, like, I listen to sports talk shows, you know, where's the spirituality on that? Because I find that's like the last place where people feel comfortable to disagree with one another. You know, like, why is this, you know, pitcher not pitching well right now? Everybody has their own opinion. Someone will call them and say, this is why this pitcher is struggling right now, this baseball pitcher. And someone else will call them and say, no. They're struggling because this is the problem. You know, and we're all listening to us and we're saying, well, I'm not sure if this is right or that is right. I think this is probably more accurate. But opinions are interesting, and I appreciate their input. I appreciate it. And, you know, sports fans, you know, they have different opinions. They get along. It's still okay to disagree. It's okay to disagree. You know, we don't hate each other because we're disagreeing. You know, at least, you know, I don't. And I may have my opinions and others have their opinions. Why is this team not doing well? You know, and so you're still experiencing this fact that it's okay to disagree. And even it's you appreciate other people's opinions because you hear somebody else's opinion. They say, hey, I hadn't thought of that before. Huh. Let me factor that in to my consideration here. But when you get into politics and religion and a lot of this other stuff, oh, you know, wow, disagreement is not allowed, you see. So the spirit of inquiry is that it's okay to differ in the way. All that matters is you're making the effort to clarify. Of inquiry, you're going to see all sorts of possibilities. And you're going to change your mind all the time because when you see it more clearly, you're going to say, oh, wait a minute, I see it more clearly. Like in science, okay, it's okay to come up with new theories, supposedly. There's a lot of politics in science, you know, a lot. And it's okay to say you're mistaken. Say, well, I thought, you know, this was how the universe works, but now I see it really doesn't work that way. And I see through new evidence, we change our minds. So pure empirical science of saying, well, this is my best theory based on the evidence I see, and yet I'm willing to change my theory. In fact, I have to if new evidence arises. That's also really good. Really, really good. But pure science has really been severely influenced now by social agendas, by agendas of those who want to oppose their conclusions on everyone else, regardless of the science. What they say is, this is the conclusion we want you to draw, science, and therefore any evidence that doesn't agree with this conclusion, you need to discard. Okay, why do those people do it? Because, again, they want to establish themselves as prime creators, which means they need a creation which is eternal, which is based on facts. And how they get facts? By having no dissent. So they want to impose in a regime of no dissent upon you. So it's very easy in this world to know who has this, who supports the spirit of inquiry and who is supporting the regime of no dissent. Very easy. It's easy to tell, you know. And it's easy to know who to support. Just ask yourself, are these people supporting my right of dissent? And that it's okay with them, that I don't agree with them? It's okay, you know, that there's various opinions, etc. Or are these people supporting, trying to reach dissent, reaching adamant conclusions about social issues, etc., and saying, this is the way you must agree to believe, and we will not tolerate dissent. If you did, we're going to put the screws on you and kind of force you through all sorts of pressures to arrive at this conclusion and say and agree that no, I don't dissent at all. And so it's obvious in the world who's on which side, where we fall on that. Who gets terrified by, you know, dissent? Or who just, you know, rolls with it and says, well, that's fine, that's good. You know, hope you come up with the answers. You know, we need to find the answer. And of course, there is one answer, which is to exchange forgetfulness of what we are for remembrance of what we are. That is the answer. That's the only answer there is. All this other stuff is subject to interpretation. It really means nothing. You know, I mean, this, what is right in the world? What is right is to exchange the world for remembrance of reality. That is what is right. It's the only thing that works. Nothing else works. So by boosting up this agenda and, you know, above another and saying, this is it. It doesn't work. It's an attempt to establish existence as real, an illusion as real, by eliminating dissent. But this teaching, on the money, it's quality teaching. And it takes a lot of courage to say this and to push away the fear, the chilly fog of fear, to point this out. Because really, in this world now, there's a tremendous effort to wipe out dissent, global effort, at the highest levels, through so many institutions, through so many means, coercion. There's this effort now to eliminate dissent, the spirit of inquiry, eliminate it. So nobody can come up, nobody feels safe to express any other conclusions than a single conclusion, whatever it is. Establish facts of existence. Whatever it may be, whatever it is, it could be just like, this picture is the greatest picture of all time, period. And no more question about it. It's been established as fact. Yeah. In other words, in existence, everything's impermanent. So the perspectives are constantly changing. Everything is constantly changing. And even if we say this one is the greatest ever, well, who's to say that there won't be a better picture come along later, right? You can't establish anything as fact here. Who's to say that this is the best system? That there'll be endlessly, is this an endless fact? Who's to say that these people are the right, what they're doing is the right way? Endlessly? You know for a fact that this is endlessly so in existence? No. You can say, well, this player was the, hit the most home runs or whatever. But is it a fact that this mark will always stand endlessly? No. Is it a fact that, whatever happens in existence, can we say for a fact that this is the best that will ever arise in existence? Reality is endless, so we have to say this is endlessly so? Is this a fact? No, it's not a fact. And it's silly to try to coerce ourselves into saying this is a endless fact. The only fact we can say about existence is that it's temporary. That trying to forget what we are is temporary. That is a fact. The only fact we can say about existence is that it's not endless. That nothing in it is endless. That is a fact. And I can say that is a fact. Because forgetfulness of endlessness is not endless. That is a fact. So we are dealing, there are facts that can be said about existence that are not open to it's simply factual. Of course, there can be dissent over interpretations of this fact. And there will be. Philosophy and religion are full of disputations, aren't they? Constantly. As long as you're dealing with an interpretation, it's open to dispute and dissent. But when you get to the ultimate fact of existence, which is existence will never be endless, it's temporary, that is a fact. We're dealing with facts. And with true facts, inherently there is no alternative to that fact. There's no interpretation of it. It stands on its own completely. The forgetfulness of endlessness is temporary. It cannot be endless. Well, that is a fact. And so if we speak in that way, then we don't feel a spirit of disputation arising. We feel, we're dealing with facts. But everything else other than that is an interpretation, is subject to dispute. And so we need to stop trying to establish facts where they cannot be established. Stop trying to establish There's no other fact about existence. There's only one fact about existence, and that it's temporary. That it can't last. That's the only fact there really is about it. So our effort to establish other facts are simply interpretations that are other than the one fact of existence. And those interpretations are not stable. They're not endless. They're not facts. So of course there will be dissent, because we'll feel, wait a minute. Someone will say, wait a minute, this isn't endless. Because they feel it. They know the feeling that it's temporary is still there. So the only way that people who take this approach, they use coercion. They have to use coercion. And history is simply, the history of existence is simply the history of coercion. That's all there is. In all so many varieties and forms, it's coercion. And you can tell, is this situation one of coercion? Or is it one of non-coercion, you know? Is it coercion to realize the one fact of existence, that it's not endless, it's temporary? Is that coercion? No. Because deep within us we know that we have no option but to realize this truth, that facts are facts, that truth is true, that lies can never become true. We know it. That's not coercion. What is coercion is trying to accept a lie as true. Then that automatically brings coercion into the picture. And that's what we have in the world, do we not? And we can all feel it, can't we? That coercion is like an avalanche in this world right now. Anyone who is attuned to the truth, it's very easy for them to see coercion at work. And they can see, they can feel very easy that coercion is this massive tsunami in the world of coercion, coming at us from behind, trying to bury us, believing that through coercion we can all agree that some lie is true, that it's permanent. A lie can be permanent. Forgetfulness of reality can be permanent. And thus that will establish ourselves as prime creator. Like magic. Yeah. That's the aim of coercion. That's the aim of existence. That is existence. Existence is coercion. At its best, existence is the will to allow ourselves to escape from coercion. Which is the premise, like, of the United States and the Constitution. All of that, the premise of it is to give us the opportunity to escape from coercion. And living in the United States, the opportunity was there to escape from coercion. So I've tried to make the most of that. The idea was to limit the means of coercion. A strong, powerful, centralized government, federal government, you know, to limit that, to try and put checks and balances on all of the types of coercion. That can also be state laws, can be laws of all different types. Checks and balances, that what it does is it makes it difficult for the mechanism of coercion to become streamlined. It's not that it doesn't get rid of coercion, but it makes it difficult for a monolithic monster with streamlined, efficient operations to then engage in this massive coercion. It makes it tough. It just bought time. The Constitution, with its checks and balances, simply bought some time for us to get free of coercion, to wake up to the one fact of existence, that existence has to be temporary, a lie can never be true. So by having these checks and balances, you know, between states' rights, federal law, between individual rights, collective rights, and then having the you know, judicial decisions in all different directions, it kind of makes it choppy, but it makes it very difficult for a monolithic machine of coercion to arise, as it has in other places who don't have these checks and balances. We see that coercion, this monolithic machine, does arise. We have to be very wise in existence. Again, the whole functioning of existence is coercion. That's its purpose, really. That's what it does. It coerces, trying to establish spirit, us as prime creators, by getting agreeing that some lie is true, so there's no dissent about this lie is true, that what existence is permanent, it's endless. And the only way to go about that is coercion. It can be subtle, it can be propaganda, it can be teaching in classrooms and just brainwashing people. There again, we've tried to make a situation where there's parents' rights, teachers' rights, states' rights, federal rights, and a whole mixture of checks and balances as far as education goes, where no monolithic educational system can be implemented. People can have homeschooling. They can pull their children out. They can have religious schooling. There's all these, varieties and choices that can be made. And there's not one monolithic educational system that can be imposed upon everyone, because then you have brainwashing. Very easy to brainwash everyone into a coercive mindset. So you have this constant conflict, between the checks and balances which prevent a monolithic coercive machine to arise, and the attempt to get rid of those checks and balances so a monolithic machine of coercion can arise. And that's the ferment in the world, in the United States, which has tried to have these checks and balances which prevent this. And so you have a society that's in conflict and ferment and, all these struggling all the time, yet you do have the opportunity to inquire into truth under those circumstances, which I've been able to do. I've been able to do it here under the system that America has had. It's given me the opportunity, and others, the opportunity to inquire without being, unduly coerced. Whereas in other places in the world, are you kidding? Wouldn't be able to say what I'm saying right here on YouTube. No way. So from the standpoint of freedom of inquiry, it's okay to say whatever conclusions you're seeing right now. It's okay. You can say there is a God. You can say there isn't a God. You say I believe in this other Savior. I believe in this and that. Because ultimately, there is an ultimate truth. And until we arrive at that ultimate truth, we're going to be dealing with interpretations. And yet if we stifle the effort to clarify by insisting on one interpretation, we'll stop this process of inquiry and we won't arrive at ultimate truth. So, one day someone might say, I believe this one is the Savior. And the next day someone will say, well, I don't believe in that Savior anymore. And the third day they might say, I found a new Savior. And the fourth day they may say, I don't believe that Savior anymore. It has to be, it goes like that. We cannot impose, because ultimately the ultimate Savior is simply seeing that existence can never be permanent, that lies can never be true. But until we reach that, we will go through interpretations. And those interpretations are bound to change. Flip-flop. There has to be a society that is not trying to impose interpretation as true, no matter how lofty it is. Because again, we have to see it for ourselves. It doesn't matter if someone else is seeing it. It doesn't matter, let's say that someone sees the truth for us. Still, we have to go through the process of seeing it for ourselves. And in that process, we're going to disagree with this Savior. We're going to say, wait a minute, I'm not so sure about what you're saying. So if you're not sure what they're saying, how can they be the Savior? You know, ultimately, the only Savior is seeing for yourself. That's the only Savior there is. There is no external Savior at all other than your own seeing, which is what Krishnamurti was saying.
None of these things mean anything to you. All probably you are so deeply conditioned psychologically, because we are biologically conditioned.
And he was involved. Some people in the Theosophical Society at that time wanted to present him as the world savior and wanted him to tell the world that he was the savior and what he said was true, that everybody should follow that. And he dissolved the order of the church and said, I am not the world savior. Your own seeing, your own clarity is the savior. You must see for yourself. And in saying that, he was being truthful to truth. He was being faithful to truth, you know. So God bless Krishnamurti by saying, you know, no, I am not the Savior. You know, let me see if I can, what can I do here? It's getting very bright, which is good, but let me, there you go. Well, that's a different look. Again, though, it's okay if some people say, you know, Krishnamurti is a savior. Krishnamurti didn't attack them. He just says, okay, that's how you're seeing it now. But I profess to you for sure that I am not your savior. Krishnamurti didn't say, when someone says, Krishnamurti, you're the savior, like when the Order of the Star and the Theosophical Society said, Krishnamurti, you're the world savior. He didn't say, well, you all need to be put in jail. You all need to be coerced. You need to be put on the rack. Yeah, you all need to be given drugs, psychoactive drugs, to change your opinions. You all need to be brainwashed. You all need to be coerced. He didn't say that. He said, look, I respect what you're saying. I respect your viewpoint. It's an interpretation. And I love all of you unconditionally. And you're all magnificent beings in truth. And I'm just, for me, I am saying I am not your savior. That your own clear seeing is your savior. He just left it at that. And you know, a lot of people respected him greatly for that. And to this day, you know, there's a lot of people respect him greatly. I don't see him as my savior. I know the own seeing, clear seeing, is my savior. It's everyone's savior. And that capacity is within everyone. It's not just within Krishnamurti. And I don't know if he saw clearly or not. That's not for me to know. My own seeing has to be clear. I have to see. Whether Krishnamurti saw clearly or not, that's his business, right? And I may either say he did or he didn't, but ultimately, whether he did or did not, I still have to see clearly that lies can never be true. Okay, I have to see that clearly. I cannot be anyone's savior. Nobody can be another person's savior. No one. That's what Krishnamurti was saying. That doesn't mean he had seen clearly or not. I don't know. I mean, I can say this right now to you. That doesn't mean that I've seen clearly. You know, I actually say I haven't seen clearly. I've seen glimpses, but it's not a permanent, you know, seeing moment by moment by moment. You know, and other people might say, oh, you have seen clearly. Well, that's their interpretation, but it's still not their own seeing clearly of truth. So you see how this is a beautiful way. It's the only way that really works. It's free of coercion. Saying, I'm okay, you're okay, what you see. But it does rest on truth and fact. But it allows one to say, well, wait a minute, you know, I don't see it yet. Okay, yeah, that's fine. But one does have to see for oneself. So it's basically saying coercion doesn't work, you know. But one is not being coerced to drop coercion. But there's a respectful, you know, disagreement. We agree to disagree on that. We're not going to throw anybody in jail. We're not going to, you know, apply coercion to anybody. One's free to listen or to not listen. What can I do with this video? I don't know. The sun is really, boom, blasting. You know, there's not much I can do about it. I don't know what I can do about it. I can shift positions like that. So, in paying attention to these talks here, this satsang, what you can get out of it if you want to is simply this realization that you must see for yourself, and the spirit of inquiry of seeing for yourself may take place for you as you put the effort into it. Maybe this is helpful to arrive at that where you feel like, you know what, I feel empowered. I feel it's okay to engage in inquiry. I feel it's okay. I don't have to agree with anyone. And just the very fact that you feel you're not coerced, that'll lead you into inquiry. The feeling that you're not coerced brings about inquiry automatically, because you look with an open mind. You say, I don't have to reach an immediate conclusion, and I don't have to reach a right or wrong conclusion. I feel I can simply observe. I'm free to observe. Free to observe. And you're not fearful that what you observe might not fit some set conclusion that coercion wants you to reach. There's no fear. So I say, well, I'll just look at this, and whatever I see, it's okay. That's how I do my inquiry. I studied A Course in Miracles, and I say, okay, I'll just look and see what I see. But I didn't feel like I had to agree with what my seeing had to agree with what the Course was saying. A lot of times it didn't. Sometimes it did. Sometimes I said, well, what I'm seeing doesn't quite agree. But I felt that that's okay. I didn't feel like what I saw had to agree with what was being said. Because what it was basically saying is just keep looking and keep trying to see. And it was saying there that truth and lies can't both be true. And then expounding upon that. But I never felt like I had to reach a conclusion or else I was going to be punished. So there was some authority that was, you know, that the author of the course was going to punish me or get mad at me, etc. I didn't experience any of that. I did feel sometimes that a little bit of ostracism, maybe. I don't know. Maybe that was just my interpretation. But I've never felt that I've been punished for not reaching some conclusion that I was supposed to reach. Okay? Neither was I persecuting the Course, saying, ah, this is all wrong. I don't see it this way. This is terrible. You know, let's get rid of this. No. You know, I said, well, you know what? As long as it's encouraging seeing for yourself, it's very helpful. Whatever is encouraging looking, feeling free to look. Whatever you see, that's okay for now. Keep looking. Just that, keep looking. This is what you see today. Okay, look at it tomorrow. And what you see tomorrow, that's okay. Look at it the next day and see what you see. That's okay. Keep looking, keep looking, keep looking. keep looking. Like this video, you know, the light keeps changing. Every, you know, keeps shifting. One moment, you know, the colors are like this. The next moment, you know, the colors are like this. It's the same one here talking, you know, but the colors keep shifting and changing, right? There you go. Whoops. So now I say today, you might say, well, at minute, you know, 1:10, it looked, this is what it looked like. And at minute 1:30, it looks like this. Now, if you have somebody at minute 1:10 looking at the video and they say, ah, oh, this is what this speaker looks like. And then they insist on it. No, the speaker looks like this. And then one at 1:30 will say, no, the speaker looks like this. And if they get in a big argument about it, that's foolish, right? Because someone will come along and say, wait a minute, you know, the speaker at 1:10 had this lighting, and the speaker at 1:30 had a different lighting because everything is changing. The sun is changing position, the sun is going through a tree and branches, and as it right now the branches are blocking it. But when the sun moves, the branches aren't blocking it, so pow, you know, hits me differently, and then I kind of need to, you know, change the lighting here so that it, you know, does it looks a little better maybe. So the lighting can change. So a wise person will say, yeah, you know, at 1:10 the lighting was this way, at 1:30 the lighting was this way, but it's the exact same speaker. All right. Actually, I'm the same at all moments, except the lighting is constantly changing, so you're getting a different video. And so, when we see that, where's the argument? Where's the dispute? We say, ah, it's like the elephant in the dark tent when they bring in these five sages, and each one has a different part of the elephant, and they're insisting, this is what it is in the tent. This is a leaf, a tree, a snake, you know, all these different, a wall, or depending on what part of the elephant they're touching in the darkness. And then someone comes in and says, ah, you know, no, it's an elephant, and they have all these different, you know, parts to them. And you're really all touching the same elephant. It's like that. So the speaker here looks the same as just this. The lighting, you know, keep shifting. And the coloration, I can color it like this. And if you've listened to this video to this point, you know, maybe, you know, you're saying, wow, okay, this is like a actual demonstration of kind of what I'm pointing out. And you realize how foolish getting in arguments is at the level of interpretations of existence. Conditions are always changing here. So don't get in dispute or arguments with people. And you can tell who really wants to dispute and argue. The spirit of dispute is very obvious. Very obvious. Immediately. You know, like someone like challenging you. You know, challenging your interpretation, and also the spirit of non-dissent the spirit of non-challenging is very obvious. Challenging your, you know, saying, hey, I think I know what is right, and I want to prove you wrong, you know, that kind of spirit is very, very obvious. And the spirit of saying, you know what, thank you for sharing your perspective and supporting my right to share my perspective. Yeah, if someone has a different viewpoint, you know, I say, oh, thank you for, you know, supporting my right to have my viewpoint too. Thank you for supporting free speech. Even if they're, you know, saying stuff that I think, wow, that's not it, but still, thank you for feeling that, you know, that you're in a place where free speech is supported, and thank you for insisting on free speech. For the expression of where you're at right now and insisting that you not be coerced into changing where you're at and supporting that other viewpoints, and that they not be coerced to accept your viewpoint. Okay? So thank you for supporting a situation where there's a minimum of coercion. Meaning you don't feel your life is threatened. You don't feel your family is threatened. You don't feel your livelihood is threatened. You don't feel your reputation is threatened. And you don't feel your social opportunities are threatened. You don't feel your friendships are threatened. You don't feel a means of expressing is threatened? Or you don't feel threatened by expressing your perspective on, no matter whether it disagrees with someone or not? But we don't really, you know, do we really have that in today's world? Can we really express any viewpoint at all and feel that we're not threatened, we're not feeling any coercion at all? Is that really true? Of course it isn't. It used to be pretty strongly true in the 60s when I you know, was here in this world. There was a time where really we could pretty much express any viewpoint at all and we really didn't feel that threatened. There was a time, you know, you could be a communist, you could be an American supporting, you know, the Constitution. You could be a capitalist. You could be on any side of any issue. You could be a fundamentalist, a Jesus freak. You could be believing in Eastern teachings. You could believe in non-dual teaching. You could believe in this and that. And, you know, we disagreed, but very few at that time felt their, you know, threat or coercion very strongly. No. It wasn't like that. It really wasn't like that. You didn't feel like you're going to lose your job. You know, if you had long hair, if you were a hippie, you know, there was a time when it was, okay, they ever said, okay, you know, that's cool. As long as you do your work, et cetera. If you had agreed in this social agenda, you know, that's okay. If you agreed that way, you know, all right. Because we kind of said, well, we don't really know. We're not sure what is true. We're kind of inquiring into it. We're on a path of inquiry. So let's not slam anyone for whatever they believe. Let's not slam them. There was that time when, you know what, you could speak up and if you got slammed, you know, people would come into your support and say, no. Don't slam them, because by slamming them, you're slamming me. You're slamming, because one day I might look at it that way too, right? How do I know? I don't really know the truth. How can I be sure that one day I might see things that way and you're slamming that? You know, one day I may support this cause, or one day I may not support this cause. How do I know? So let's be cool. Let's everyone get along. I'm okay, you're okay. You know, that really was here to a large extent, thanks to people like Krishnamurti. Thanks to great beings, free beings like Ramana Maharshi and Ananda Maima, and many others. Thanks to them, we had a lot of people saying, wait a minute, maybe I don't know the truth. Maybe I don't know the answer. I mean, a lot of people went to Ramana Maharshi, Ananda Maima, and other teachers. Punjaji, Air Baba, and a lot of saints and sages and pundits and teachers from all different traditions, a lot of Zen teachers, a lot of Buddhist teachers, a lot of Christian sages and saints, a lot of Islamic teachers, Sufis, etc., from all different traditions, and they had access to them because of the transportation, etc. People had money to travel, and they'd realize, wait a minute, I feel like I don't have the answers. I feel like I'm just interpreting things, and I don't know ultimate truth. They said, wait a minute, my friends don't know ultimate truth. I don't know it. I'm aware there is ultimate truth, and I know I don't know it. So let me not be so quick to condemn my brother and sister for their viewpoints, and let them not be so quick to condemn my viewpoints, because we may go through a process here in trying to find ultimate truth, where we may flip-flop, flip-flop, flip-flop. And if I condemn my brother and sister, I may condemn my own path. I may short-circuit my path. Because one day I may support, you know, communism, and the next day I may support capitalism. And then I may flip-flop, and then I may say I don't support either one. Right? So let me not have a spirit of condemnation of anyone. One day I may be supporting women's rights, feminism. The next day I may not be supporting it. Okay? And then I may say, you know what? It's really not the supporting it or not supporting it. So let me not be in a spirit of condemnation. Because these were all invitations. Why? Because I was sitting with Ramana Maharshi and I realized there is an ultimate truth. And I realized that existence is in it. It can't be found in existence. So how can supporting something in existence be an ultimate truth? It cannot. Okay. So let me not have a spirit of condemnation. That was the profession and the creed for a while. A lot of it coming from the great, like Christianity. Hate the sin, love the sinner. Let me not have a spirit of condemnation. Very important. And let us not be so certain of our interpretations of what sin is necessarily, right? What we should say is, let us not have a spirit of condemnation towards anyone. Because that opens up the path of my inquiry. It enables my inquiry to continue. And so that's all I'm saying. That's all Krishnamurti was saying. That's all any teacher's saying. And we get that spirit by sitting, being aware of a teacher that knows ultimate truth, that knows that lies can never be true, that knows it perfectly well and has accepted it entirely, and who is then experiencing unconditional love and multidimensionality, and who's literally abiding in that. By being aware of those teachers, we then automatically we realize, oh wow, I should not have a spirit of condemnation within me. You know, if we're like a conservative, we say, no, I don't have a spirit of condemnation to those who oppose that. If we're a progressive, we say, I don't have a spirit of condemnation to those who see things differently. And they say, wait a minute, what's important is not progressivism or conservatism or anything, but my path of inquiry and your path of inquiry and the spirit of non-condemnation, which allows inquiry to take place. Without feeling that what I see, I might end up being attacked for what I see. I may have a lifestyle and an inquiry. I may see, oh my gosh, my lifestyle, that's not helping my inquiry. I want to change my lifestyle. Like, I used to listen to a certain style of music. And then through inquiry, I realized that, you know, this style of music is kind of not so good for my inquiry right now. I want to change what I listen to as far as music goes. And I did. And now later on, I'm seeing, you know, this music that I have been listening to, I kind of want to drop that music too because it's not so helpful for my inquiry now. So, you know, I'm kind of doing that too. So I've changed my musical styles a lot. You know, at one point, maybe this music was helpful for my inquiry. Now its inquiry has deepened in some way, and now I feel, you know, I don't want that music anymore. So we cannot say, you know, this music is best for everyone. This has to be the only music there is. Because depending on where our inquiry is at, different styles of music may be helpful to us. Depending where our inquiry is at, different lifestyles may be where it's at. But as our inquiry deepens, I guarantee you that your lifestyle may change, your music may change. You may say, hey, you know, I need to have a different situation for myself to help my inquiry along. And we may look at our lifestyle we had in the past and we say, wow, I don't want any part of that anymore because that was really distracting me, you know. There was a lot of coercion there. Maybe I need to be freer than that. So we don't condemn our previous lifestyle, but we also say, you know, let's not see that as something that's permanently right. There's nothing in existence, you know, no lifestyle. We can say this is permanently it necessarily. Only our seeing that lies cannot be true brings us then to awaken to a reality. Only that is right, ultimately. How we get there, you know, is not of ultimate importance. It's actually getting there that's important. And others may arrive there in different ways. So again, we must have a spirit of non-condemnation. We must practice that. And it's easy to see what the spirit of the times is. Is the spirit of the times going towards non-condemnation? Or is it going to extreme condemnation and judgment on all sides? You know, what is the present situation in the world right now? What is the present situation? It's pretty, you know, it's obvious. Going to a spirit of condemnation. Very, very obvious. And of course, people are free to disagree with this too. This is my, you know, seeing. It's very obvious to me. But I respect others if they have a different viewpoint. But for me, of course, I am seeing that and aware of that. That there is a very, very strong push to arrive at some kind of, you know, permanent consensus to try and establish existence as real, as lies as true, as temporary as permanent. Very strong push. And it's all that's happening is trying to arrive at what is that consensus going to be, you know. That's why the people are so combative right now. They say, we want this to be, you know, the consensus here. Let us have consensus and agreement around this interpretation. And there's another group that says, let us have consensus and agreement around this interpretation. And they're just battling over what interpretation we're going to have consensus around. Which is very, very different than the spirit of non-condemnation. We're really not trying to arrive at any agreement or consensus on any interpretation. We're trying to arrive at ultimate truth. And how do we get to this place? Because we did not pay enough attention to those who have arrived at ultimate truth. When those great, great beings who have arrived at ultimate truth passed on from this world, when Ramana Maharshi passed on, when Anandi Mai Ma passed on, when Bunjaji passed on, when these various great teachers, sages, saints, saviors, gurus, when they passed on from this world, you know, people really began forgetting about them. And when we forgot that there is an ultimate truth about existence, which is existence can never be permanent, and that we must ultimately give it up. When that wasn't being brought through to many, 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 then the spirit of non-coercion, you know, began to dwindle, dissipate. You know, bit by bit by bit by bit by bit, and, you know, here we are now. You know, are people seeking out those great beings of who tell it, that let us be aware that there is an ultimate truth? Are they seeking them out? Or are they playing, you know, games on their smartphones? You know, as a child, I sought those teachers out automatically. That's, for me, that was the only thing of importance. Where are the teachers? Where are the great teachers of truth? I have to find them. I have to, you know that they're here. Let me find them. And someone said, wow, why don't we play Scrabble or, you know, these checkers or, you know, why don't you play these silly games? And I said, no. I'm off to the bookstore. You know, I want to find these teachers. Where are they? But, you know, today, you know, you look at the youth, you know, and, you know, they're like, you know, moving these little things around, little, you know, sending these little bombs, you know, at birds or something. I mean, you know, just really incredibly inane and silly stuff, which, of course, they have a right to do so. But if we do not, if we're not aware of ultimate truth, that there is ultimate truth, we automatically will believe that we can establish an ultimate truth in existence. And we'll automatically then go toward coercion, automatically. And the spirit of inquiry, the spirit of non-judgment, non-condemnation, the spirit of non-condemnation, will dry up, will dry up. Most people in the world are unaware, you know, that there is ultimate truth. And so, of course, for them, what other path is there except to try and establish existence as ultimate truth? Which means then they need to come up with facts, which means they have to coerce agreement. So they have to go coercion. To them, they're simply following a logical path, but it's based on a false premise. It's based on believing there's no such thing as ultimate truth. It's based on unawareness of these great teachers that have presented ultimate truth, whether it be Jesus or Buddha or whoever, you know, Ananda Maima, teachers that were completely aware of ultimate truth, that truth is true, and that no lies can be true. Absolutely 100% in complete agreement with this and abiding in this fact without any effort to try to change this fact. Awareness of those teachers then brings to us, aha, there is an ultimate truth. Existence is not it. Therefore, why should I try to spend time coercing others into trying to establish some fact in existence when I know that everything in existence is temporary, so there can be no facts, can be no ultimate facts at all? It's a waste of time. Let me spend my time dropping that effort and remembering, you know, that truth, remembering my function in truth. Let me spend my time that way. So that is why I insist that it's supremely important to be aware of ultimate truth, and those who come in the world and show, come into existence and say, you know what, even though existence, we're aware of it, there is an ultimate truth and it's not existence. I place a greater premium on those who have come into the world than any teaching, any channel teaching, or anything like that. I place a higher premium on that. You know, Ananda Maima was here for how many years? 86 years. Krishnamurti was here for, I think, 80, more than that. You know, 80, almost 90 years, I guess. Maybe he was here like 89 years or something. They were here. They were actually here walking around in the same, seemingly in existence, and yet saying, hey, existence is not true. It's not an ultimate truth. You can never establish existence as reality. It's temporary. But they were here, and so we can say, this is definitely true, because even being here, they still witness to truth. That's powerful. Whereas if you have a channel teaching, it can turn us to inquiry and seeing the truth for ourselves, yes. But it's not quite as powerful, in my opinion, as someone who's actually here. That has, you know, that's the ultimate in convincing, you know, like, wow, even here in existence, they still reject existence in all interpretation. They still insist there is ultimate fact that existence is temporary. Even under the influence of all of the stuff of existence, they're still witnessing that perfectly. Whereas if we're not in existence, you know, we're in a spiritual, you know, being, I think it's a lot easier to say these things. Whereas if we're here and everybody's hammering their interpretations on us and insisting they can establish lies as true or all the aggravations of existence, if we still perfectly witness to truth, that is, you know, that's as impressive as it gets. Really. That's why I say Ananda Maima was as impressive as you're ever going to get in this world, because she was in that condition her entire life flawlessly. And she said she was never inconvenienced or aggravated by anything in existence whatsoever. because she never identified with any of it whatsoever, because she is 100% established that truth is true and never felt any temptation to depart from that. Never. So, you know, you can't get any better than that. You can't be any more convincing than that. So, you know, that's powerful. Very powerful. Which is why I've always said it's very important to have these beings in the world. Very important. And for some reason, right now, it doesn't seem like we have an embarrassment of riches in that way. And it would be very good to have an embarrassment of riches, and that way you can't have, you know, enough. You can't have too much of that, really. Cannot have too much of it. And again, it is more powerful to have someone actually animating a body who's witnessing in that way, who is not tempted in any way to even consider departure from truth. Here in this world, that is, you know, wow. We see that and we say, oh, there is an ultimate truth, and existence cannot affect it in any way. And we can be free. We can realize ultimate truth. Even here, as we're struggling with all these interpretations, we can do it. It's possible. Yes, yes it is. But what do? If we don't have access to that, we continue our inquiry. Yeah, we can't just give up, because truth is still true. We just have to keep praying for greater and greater clarity, and that we will truly be established in certainty that truth is true and that lies can never be true. Yeah, A Course in Miracles says all this, you know, perfectly well. You know, but it still has to be realized with total certainty, where we're no longer even tempted to depart from this. Where we realize that the temptation is futile, it's useless, it's just a waste of time. We're not even tempted to it whatsoever. You know, the story is that Jesus was tempted and he just said, get behind me, Satan, I'm not even tempted at all. So there's no reason for you to even tempt me anymore, you know, because it has no purpose. You know, we need to get to that point where we're not even tempted to be tempted. Ananda Mayama was that way. She was not even tempted to be tempted. Zero interest in that. In other words, she didn't feel like she needed to somehow prove that she, you know, is not being tempted. There's none of that there at all. So that's really, when I talk about great gurus, that's what I'm talking about. Is they have no desire to even prove to anyone that they're not being tempted. None. That's a whole, you know, that's as high as it gets. In other words, there's not even any spiritual ego. There's nothing there even saying, look, I'm not even being tempted, and I need to prove it to you by showing that I'm not being tempted. There's not even any desire for that there arising at all. They simply are here witnessing to truth. Now, you might say that those who don't come into the world can say, well, I have no desire to prove that I'm not being tempted, so I'm not going to even arrive in this world. And yet it's even higher to actually arrive in this world and yet have no desire to, that you're arriving in this world can prove that you're not being tempted either. You know, that's even greater stuff. Very rare. And those people, those great beings, literally, if we don't ask them to help us, they will just sit in a heap on the floor and do nothing. Because they have zero desire to do anything. They're not trying to prove anything here. Ananda Mayama said, literally, if those who came to her didn't engage her and say, please help us, you know, realize truth, and please witness to us, etc. She said she would literally be lying on a heap on the floor in a death-like condition. Wouldn't even be moving. Wouldn't be eating. Wouldn't be doing anything. And sometimes she'd be that way. Really? Like a sack of rags on the floor. Like dead. No heartbeat. No pulse. No breath. No nothing. In a state of extremely withdrawn from this world. And literally the devotees would have to sing songs and ask for spiritual guidance and have to make a great effort, the true desire to be helped on their spiritual path in order to bring her back into functionality. And they realized, you know, that, wow, we really have to make use of this teacher here. Otherwise, she's just going to do nothing. And it was true. Scared the heck out of them. As the world got more and more materialistic, she became more and more withdrawn and seemed to just be really almost like a sack of rags, you know, just kind of detached and disinterested as the world became more and more materialistic and scientific and thinking that, you know, we want to explore more interpretations. She became more and more withdrawn. That's true. And the presence seemed to dwindle because, again, she had no desire to prove anything. So if we didn't ask for it, it would seem to dwindle. So as our aspiration dwindled and we became more and more intrigued with high technology, as a matter of fact, her presence seemed to dwindle here right at the time when high technology really took root in this world. Early 70s, really. It took root a little earlier than that, but so during the 60s it started dwindling a little bit, but during the 70s it really started to dwindle. And by the time the 80s were here, she, you know, just seemed to be very withdrawn. Wasn't the same. Because why? Because people started seeing the spiritual path of ultimate truth. They said, wait a minute, we've got the means now to really dig into existence and maybe, well, what they really were feeling, let's be perfectly clear here, was people were saying, oh, wait a minute. We now have the means to apply a massive coercion and arrive at a consensus on facts. So we now can establish ourselves, existence as eternal, and ourselves as prime creator. You know, it's like, oh, we do have the means to do this. Wait a minute, we have these very advanced means of coercion. And as people began to see how high technology could be used to coerce the entire planet, they suddenly, you know, lost their interest in these great gurus. They lost their interest in Ramana Maharshi and Ananda Maya Mom. Ramana was gone by that time. When did he leave? Like 1957 or something like that. In the 50s, but Ananya Maimon was still here when high technology, you know, began to take root. People, the spirit changed, spirit of the world changed when people said, oh my gosh, I think I see a way we can bring about world consensus. And therefore they said, I think I see a way that I can be prime creator. That is what happened. When high technology arrived for me, I said, uh-oh. And I refused to engage with it. I said, whoa. This is going to really cause the world to go astray. For instance, I refuse to use calculators in school. I said, forget it. I'll do it on paper or in my head. I didn't use a calculator. Even to this day, I use calculators at all. I rejected it. And I kept my interest in ultimate truth. So when the world turned towards saying, wow, we got a way to implement a worldwide consensus, they lost their interest in Ananda Maya Ma, and her presence faded. Really, I mean, for me, it's obvious. I could see, you know, that if you look at her history of video, you can see her presence is very faded, and it wasn't old age either, because when someone would go to her in old age with her faded presence and they brought genuine and said, you know, real spiritual inquiry to her, they said, their own testimony was, my gosh, I saw this old woman, feeble old woman, but when I came to her, this disappeared, and I saw this vibrant, completely vibrant, immense being, and the old, infirm woman disappeared entirely. There are many testimonies to that, because as we came to her, the great guru, as we brought our intent, so we saw her, as it were. But of course, videos have a flatness to them, you know. So to the video camera, she appeared to be old and feeble and, you know, all of that. But certain devotees, when they would come to her with her true intent to see, is there ultimate truth, show me this, they didn't see infirmity or age whatsoever. She appeared to them as ageless, this spiritual being that was completely free of infirmity or age whatsoever. That's how she had appeared to them that way. And she would insist that her age, all this aging body, is because that is what you want. That is what you're seeing it, because that is what you want. Why do you want that? Because you're being tempted and seduced into advanced means of coercion, thinking that you can establish yourself, you can establish ultimate truth for yourself. And you're being tempted to do that. That is why you're seeing me age and vanish from the scene. He said, if you really were not tempted to turn away, to establish your own ultimate truth for yourself, if you were not tempted, she says, I would not be aging. You would not see me as infirm and getting old. Just that is a fact. But because the mood of the world is this way, I appear to be aging. And she says, I appear to die because your desire to have me here is dying. But really, and of course, those who knew her said, you know what? They said, you know, you can cast off death if you wanted to. We know you can. We know you can literally stay here indefinitely if you have the mood to do that. She said, yes, but you don't want me to. And they pleaded with her, and yet the mood of the times was such that they wanted her to die. That is the truth. That is the truth of great gurus. What they are is deathless. Truth cannot die. And what they are is literally truth here. And the body is just a veil so that we can relate to something familiar. But that body doesn't have to die, actually. It's what dies is our interest in the great teacher. And I've always believed that a great guru can arise for us if our intent is so strong enough. You know, but the mood of the world is so distracted, I don't know if it's possible right now. It may not be possible to bring an actual physical body into the world of a great guru, because the mood of the world is so distracted right now that it's so seduced by high technology. High technology, why? Because its capacity to bring about massive coercion, to reach a consensus, which can then be interpreted as fact, which can then be interpreted as existence being eternal, which can then be interpreted as us being the, of course, we are the creators of existence. We're bringing it existence, or we're dreaming it. That would establish us as prime creators. And the plausibility that this can be accomplished is so strong now, but there's not a whole lot of us here on this planet that would prefer our attention to be focused on a being that is established in ultimate truth. That's established in truth. There may not be enough mood will, interest in that for any teacher to arise on this planet that is flawlessly established in that. We may not get it. Perhaps we can be aware of it in the subtle body. Perhaps a guru, one who's established an ultimate truth, flawlessly established. Okay. There are those who are aware of ultimate truth. And say they are flawlessly establishing it to the point where they have no even desire to prove that they're flawlessly establishing it. Again, absolutely zero desire to prove that she was established in ultimate truth, flawlessly established in whatsoever. Zero desire. I don't see anyone in the world that's that way. Okay? I do see some who are established in ultimate truth, and they want to still prove that they are established in it. You know, which is okay. But no one who has even no desire whatsoever, one way or the other, to establish that they're in ultimate truth or not, or to show that they're not tempted to leave ultimate truth. I don't see anyone that is that way. And maybe nobody can be brought into the world in a body and during these times that is that way. So far, no. So maybe we have to settle for subtle body, being able to see a subtle body, not a physical body. Because at the level of physicality right now, the mood of the world is so engrossed in trying to coerce a consensus that we have zero interest in turning towards one who even has no desire to prove that they're not even tempted by this. We simply don't have the attention there. We cannot put our attention there. And so they cannot appear. They cannot appear. Ananda Maima appeared because there was enough people in the world where she appeared that wanted that. It was in East Bengal where she first appeared, which is the area now known as Bangladesh. And there was enough intent in that area, and then later in the Gangetic Plain in northern India, there was enough intent that she appeared. And she said, you know, people said, why are you here? She says, you brought me here. I didn't bring myself here at all. She said, I had zero intent to come here. I have nothing to prove. I have no to prove anything. But your desire for me to be here, for you to be helped, for you to turn to ultimate truth, your desire and intent for that was strong enough that you brought me here. So she says, now make use of me. Because if you don't want to make use of me, I'll be a heap of rags in the corner. And so they made use of her. Many did. So there was that amazing willingness in that place and time for this presence to appear that really who had no desire to prove that they weren't even tempted by falsity or lies at all. No, not even a desire to prove that at all. They actually appeared here. And people got this full blast, you know. Doesn't get any better than that. And, but of course then, you know, technology came in the world and turned everyone's heads. So that they said, wait a minute. We don't really need this because we want to pursue this consensus way of it to arrive at consensus. And maybe we can be prime creators. And that really interests us, you know. Instead of realizing that ultimate truth is set for us, we think we saw a way for us to establish what ultimate truth is. We thought we saw a way that we can establish and determine what ultimate truth is, instead of having ultimate truth established for us. And then that led to Ananda Maima's departure from this world. And, you know, she hasn't returned. I thought, you know, maybe she could return. She has not, you know. So a guru like that can literally manifest again. If the intent of the world is such that it happens, there's nothing preventing it to manifest again. But it hasn't happened. And probably will not happen. I have to accept that as just from my own clarity of seeing. There's not the will, there's not the allowance, there's not the call for that to happen in the world at all. There only might be a handful of people in the world that really want that to happen. There may be only a handful of people in the world who want somebody here who is here without the slightest desire to prove that they are free of temptation, the temptation to believe in lies. Not even a desire to prove that to us at all. In other words, what they're saying is, truth is not the slightest bit concerned about lies. Truth is not the slightest bit concerned that we might be able to establish truth, independent truth, our own truth. Not even the slightest bit concerned about that. See, our egos, our desire to establish truth for ourselves, be the establishers of our own truth, is so strong that we don't want to see that. We want to believe that truth is at least a little bit concerned about this. So we want a guru here is at least saying, yeah, I need to prove to all of you that I'm not tempted by lies. That's probably as far as anyone wants to go right now. And even then, there's only maybe a few that want that. So those are the teachers that we get. You know, we get the teachers that we want. And for those, what happened was the spirit of coercion said, hey, I think we really can establish our own truths. What happened was that gave rise to teachers, false teachers, you know, egomaniac teachers, egomaniacal gurus that gave rise to them in this world. And a lot of people went that direction. And it gave rise to very coercive teachers, you know, severely coercive teachers, because people wanted to find out advanced means of coercion so that they could coerce consensus, so that they could establish existence as eternal, and therefore they could say that we're prime creators and that we are the ones who are establishing truth. So that's why coercive teachers came on the scene, and why non-coercive teachers vanished from the scene. Vanished. So, what can we do? It may be that the most we can get is a subtle body awareness of a true, of the highest kind of teacher, highest witnessing. One who's not even, again, the slightest, has no desire to prove to us that they're the highest master. Because they know truth is not threatened in the slightest bit. Doesn't need to prove itself in any way. And yet they're not against appearing, you know. But can we bring them into the actual physical realm? Probably not. It's not happened. It's not happened. So maybe we have to see them in the subtle realm. That is possible. So maybe I cannot, you know, present them here on video. Because video is incapable of recording the subtle realm. Maybe it's possible to see them in the subtle realm and to convey, if they say something subtly, to convey that on video. Possible. Some would say that's channeling, but it may not be channeling. It may be that you can see, you know, a perfect teacher in the subtle realm, clear day, and they're actually, you know, they're there 100%, and they can convey something very clearly, and then that can be conveyed here. But I have to admit that my efforts to bring about a, you know, highest teacher here in the world hasn't happened. No matter what I've done, hasn't happened. Cannot get the requisite willingness here. Because again, Ananda Mama said she only appeared in this world because there's a tremendous desire her that had built up, desire for the highest teacher, the highest type of teacher to come in the world. Oh, that's the only reason she said she appeared. And that wasn't just because one person was asking for it. There was a cultural desire for it, a strong desire for it. And that was proven by the fact that millions went to see her, millions and millions. And just said, wow, thank you for coming here. We're so grateful for you coming here. You know, gosh, thank you so much. And she just said, well, thank yourself for asking for me to come here. But in today's world, will there be millions and millions react that way? No. Because they'd say, well, you know, I really don't really quite see what the purpose of this is. And, you know. So I don't know exactly what I can do for all of us, for myself, for you, etc. You know, there's a small willingness here. Some are willing to listen to these videos because they're thinking, you know, there's something here. You know what I'm saying? What can I do more to help? And so I'm still searching for how to be more helpful. What can I do? And again, videos are, you know, they can't record multidimensionality. They cannot record the subtle realm. So we're all at this point still stuck in, you know, in self-inquiry as the best we can do. For the most part, some have access to teachers who are, to some, you know, to an extent, witnessing that only truth is true. But I've always been, you know, trying to orient towards, you know, how can you get that which is going to truly break the stranglehold of being tempted to establish facts for ourselves? Because that's critical. It's absolutely all important. We do have to, hold on 1 second here. Okay, just had to answer a question there from someone. What can be done? I'm still trying to find ways to be more helpful, more helpful. But it may be that we literally cannot bring through the highest here in the physical plane at this time. That's a likelihood, very probable. That's true. But yet that doesn't leave us, you know, with no options at all. I'm seeing that there are some options, and hopefully we can experience those options. I keep praying that we can, but the realization that, you know, we may not be able to have the highest option here because, of, you know, the call for it isn't strong enough. It's not strong enough. I keep thinking that, you know, the situation in the world is getting so bad, it should be very obvious now to so many, but it's not. Temptation is still there, you know. Feeling that, wow, we might be able to establish ourselves as prime creator, the establishers of truth. We can establish truth for ourselves. That temptation is still has gotten into people through technology. It really has. To some degree, whereas prior, you know, people did not have that temptation, and it was a little easier for them to turn towards ultimate truth. It's tough now. It really is tough. It's doable, but it's tough because you have to see through technology. You really do. You have to see it for the, you know, the coercive equipment that it is. It's the technology of coercion, really. And you have to see that's folly, that's path of futility, just a waste of time. You have to really see it. All right. Now I have to deal with the evening here. So, you know, this has been another really great video for me to participate in. And the reason why these videos are so long is the material that I'm bringing through is unexpected, you know. I don't really know what's going to come out when I start these videos. And the videos kind of build and get better and better and better and better and better as I go along. And the material gets, wow, deeper and deeper and deeper. So I just keep continuing until I feel like it's reached a point where we've really done everything we can do for this video. And at that point, I say, okay, enough's enough. So we're going to end this video for now, and we will try to do even better in the future. So, for now, for this video, that's it.